So this is a talk about Laval dispersion and connectivity. So this is a quick outline of the different parts of the talk. So I will go on some background first with the pelagic cycle, and then some definition that are good to know when it comes to larval dispersion. And then I will talk a little bit about how you can go on modeling some biological processes, and then have a quick introduction on L-trans, but it was already introduced before on Gabby's slides. And then I will go over a case study that considers the Caribbean spiny lobster. So I will show some preliminary results that we have so far, and then finish on the next steps. So this is a quick overview just to show you how important the pelagic cycle is for some species. So most of the benthic marine invertebrate go through this dispersal larval stage. And you have a few pictures of some larvae. So you have the Ophiopluteus larvae. So this is for the larval stage for some echinoderms. I think in English it's called for the brittle star. And then on the right, you have the Phyllosoma larvae. So this one is quite special because it has a very long larval duration. So this is the larvae for the spiny lobster, for example. And then you have the Veliger larvae. This is the larval stage for some sea snails. And you can see they have very different morphological shapes. So this will offer them different abilities to swim in the water column. So they all have a different duration. So this can go from days to months. And understanding their how they are transported, it's very important to better understand marine population dynamics. So here are very quick definition. So you have the larval transport. So on the little diagram here, this is what's represented in blue. So this is determined by advective and diffusive processes, and it can also be affected by the larval behavior. So the swimming abilities, for example. And you have the dispersal here in green on the diagram. And this phase goes from the spawning event until the settlement. And then if you have a successful dispersal, you have a connectivity. And here is a formal definition of what connectivity is from Cohen and Sponocle. And we have the pelagic larval duration. That is the time window that you have between the spawning to the last stage of the metamorphosis into the juvenile stage. So during all these events, so you have the spawning, then the settlement, and then you have specific larval history traits that are very important to assess if you want to parameterize your particle tracking model. So this is a table that summarizes some of these parameters that you can investigate for. So this is presented for two species. So you have the spiny lobster and the queen conch. So you want to know for these two species when they will spawn. And so basically what, when, and where, so which species, when. So for the spiny lobster, it spawns between March and June. And for queen conch, it's between March and October. And you have a depth range of where they are located for the spawning. So for the spiny lobster, it's up to 100 meter depth, and a queen conch, it's not a particular depth, but it's shallow waters usually. And then you want to have information for the transport. So you want to know the competency periods. So this is the time window when the species will be able to settle. So we choose 175 to 210 days after release, and for the spiny lobster and for the queen conch, it's day 25 to 30 after the release. So you can see the spiny lobster is characterized by a very high pelagic larval duration from 5 to 9 months, which is a lot, whereas the queen conch is around a month. And for both of these species, you can include some behavior. So for the spiny lobster, you can have diurnal migration or ontogenic migration as well. And you want to decide where they will settle. And for the spiny lobster and the queen conch, it's usually reefs or shallow areas. So this is just one slide about the LTRANS model. So I put again the website where you can download it. And this particle tracking model used specifically as inputs ROMS, hydrodynamics datasets, but you can also adapt it using another type of hydrodynamic model like NEMO. And so this is what we have been using. So the White Caribbean model that we already talked about. So we use this hydrodynamic fields to feed in into the particle tracking model. So this is some screenshots of the data file that you can parameterize for your particle tracking model. So you have a lot of initial conditions for the number of particles you want to simulate, the time you want to simulate, and then you can also set up some behavior module. So you have already some existing behavior that you can use that are already coded and available, but you can also implement your own module for behavior. And so now I will just talk about some results we have so far for the Caribbean spiny lobster study. So before doing any experiments, you want to gather as much information as you can on your species of interest. So this is a simplified representation of key elements during the pelagic cycle, the pelagic phase of the spiny lobster. So we have the duration of the larval release. So this is the spawning event between March and June. So usually the lobster will go into deeper depths to release its eggs, and usually at night. And during the larval phase, they can have either diurnal migration throughout the day and ontogenic migration. So usually the later stage of the species, they will be deeper into the water column. And then at the end, once it will metamorphose into the post larvae, it will be able to settle if there is an habitat, a suitable habitat to settle. So we first define the spawning area. So this is the initial location of your particles. So we choose a depth of 80 until 130 meter depths, and we uniformly seed into these isobats. And then after, at the end, you want to select your target. So you want to say where you want your particle to be able to settle. And we use the database of reefs for the Caribbean Arc Islands. So they are on the right figure in red. So this is the reefs. And we choose this as the suitable settlement habitat for the lobster larvae. And this is a very schematic steps for all the analysis. So you want first to configure your particle tracking model. And once you feed it in with all your initial condition and your parameters, if you want to include behavior or not, and then you run your model, and the duration will greatly vary depending on your initial condition. And you end up with trajectories which have a coordinate, so lat long values, and then a time that is attributed to this location, and a depth. And so here in this case, we choose to first do an experiment where we have passive particles, so we didn't include any behavior for the particle. And the key parameters to have in mind if you want to simulate your larval transport are the number of particles and the release depths and your particle tracking time that depends on your pelagic larval duration. So in the table, you can see all the parameters we used for our passive experiment. And after that, you can do a settlement analysis. So you usually define during the competency period for your particle to settle inside a reef, if there is a reef. So this is an example of the trajectory you can obtain after running L-trans. So in yellow, this is the trajectory after the first month's release. And then you have all the other colors for the other successive months. And you can see that we seeded in the Caribbean arc, and you can see that the particle traveled quite far from their original position. And then we try to see if there is any connection between different areas. And we did a monthly release during the spawning time, and we only obtain a very low settlement rate. Because as you see in the previous slide, the particles will actually go very far outside the original spawning location. Yeah. And so the next steps are to maybe implement a nested model to have a higher resolution hydrodynamic fields and use that to the particle tracking model. And we can also look at implementing some behavior for the particle, for example, the vertical migration. And because on the example I just showed you, we only had a very few connection between some areas. Sometimes for other species, it can be way more complex. And for that, we can use another software that will help for the analysis and the data visualization. So an example of software is here. It's called Gephi. That's free and also to use. And this is just to show that the connectivity can greatly vary when you consider another species. So this is for the queen conch. This one has a shorter larval duration, and it was released more at the surface, not as deep as the spiny lobster. And it's way more complex to analyze. So I think I can just leave you here with this take-home message.